base to base tag, right?
Anybody get up before sun up this morning, go outside? Wasn't that about as good a morning as you could ever find? My, cool and 66 degrees in Oklahoma and tail end of July. Wow. Good to see everybody out. I've been absent on vacation for 5 weeks.
Nice to see him back.
I wouldn't recommend it. I wouldn't recommend it for anybody yet, but anyway, it's good to be back. I appreciate the cards and the texts and the text cards and the prayers and the phone calls, and I've been crippled up a little bit, but I'm about back to whatever normal is. It's good to be here. We're going to sing a few songs. Turn over to 92, all four verses.
Jesus, oh, Son of Jesus.
Take your song book, turn over 235. Turn over to 337. Nothing but the blood.
Jesus.
last one, page 193. God has been good to us out here, let me tell you, and are we good? He's always been good to us, but he sent us some more talent, and we're just glad Danny has become part of our church, him and Sheila, and they bring so much professionalism and talent to us up here. I think I'm going to stay home sometime, but anyway, here's Danny and the girls going to sing a couple.
Thank you, Bill. Well, Charlie had his angels. This is a song, by the way, is Angels Among Us. And these are not Charlie's angels. These are my angels today. How about that for an introduction, huh? Getting late, I was scared and alone, but then a kind old man took my hand and led me home. Mama couldn't see him, oh, but he was standing there, and I knew in my heart he was the answer to my prayer. Believe there are angels among us, sent down to us from somewhere up above. They come to you and me in our darkest hours to show us how to live, to teach us how to give, and to guide us with the light of had troubled times and had me down on my knees. Their There's always been someone to come along and comfort me. A kind word from a stranger to lend a helping hand, or a phone call from a friend just to say, I understand. Ain't it kind of funny, at the dark end of the road, someone lights the way with just one single ray of hope. Oh, I believe there are angels among us, sent down to us from somewhere up above. They come to you and me in our darkest hour, to show us how to live, to teach us how to give, and to guide us with the light of love. They wear so many faces, show up in the strangest places, they grace us with their mercy. Somewhere up above, they come to you and me in our darkest hours, to show us how to live, to teach us how to give, and to guide us with the light of love. Show us how to live, to teach us how to give, and to guide us with the light of love. I had a request to do this. This other song, too, if y'all don't mind humoring me for just a minute. There's an old joke that went around for several years. Some of you may have heard it, but it's about this little boy that's on the beach, and there are thousands of starfish on the beach, and he's walking along and picking one up at a time and throwing it back out into the ocean. And a guy came along, and he said, "Son, what are you doing? Do you think that'll make a difference?" He picked up one of those starfish and threw it out in the ocean. He said, "It made a difference to that one." So, just you never know what a kind word or a smile or just a kind gesture to someone might mean to their day or even to their life. Maggie came home one day with a raggedy, raggedy hand. She said, "Mama, look what I found in the neighbor's garbage can. It had a missing left arm and a right button eye hanging by a thread. She carried it gently up to her room and laid it on her bed. With her other dogs, she loved the broken ones that need a little patching up. She sees the diamond in the rough, then makes it shine like it really doesn't take that much. A willing heart and a tender touch. If everybody loved like she does, there'd be a lot less broken ones." Almost too weak to stand. She said, "I'm lost and I need help. Maggie takes her hand and says, come on in.
Preacher, that's going to be hard to follow, you know. Woo. Boy, it's good to see everybody out today and on this beautiful Sunday. And we always give a gift to a visitor that's never been here before on Sunday morning. And if you're an adult, one per family, raise your hand if you've never been here on a Sunday. We got in. Got two right here in the middle, Don. Keep your hand up. Here comes Don behind you. Is that it? Do we have any children? First-time visitors. You're a children, too? You're their children. I thought the... That was you, and it's good to see you here today, and you still running and swimming and jumping and all that triathlon. Oh, my. On purpose? In that cup, you'll find a ballpoint pen, one of these beautiful OSU pens, and there's a tag on the handle. And if you would, fill out that for us and drop it back here in this feed bucket. And we're going to put you in a hopper for a grand prize someday. Maybe. Dave, you got an announcement?
Yeah. I failed to mention this morning in Sunday school. Next Sunday, we're going to start the next lesson in our study guide book. So we're on 121 and you number 13. If you need a book, they're in a box back by the back piano. Thank you.
Also, if you want to sign up for the breakfast bar, there's a piece of paper back there on the cedar table. Sign up for it. Like I said a while ago, I've been gone for 5 weeks. Some people may not know this. I had a knee on them aftermarket parts, knees, put in, and I've got several parts on two hips and two knees. And
bionic.
Yeah, and the doctor told me before I left up there, he said, watch out for scrap yards. Don't get out where that big magnet is, you know. But anyway, it's good to see everybody out, and we appreciate your attendance. We've got some return visitors and some folks that we're just glad everybody's here today. Give you a quick report on Sister Deanie. She's getting lots better. She's playing the piano at home, and that's her healing, I think. But she's still on a walker. She's still got some pain. Sisters, sister-in-laws, and whoever's still catering food to her. She kind of likes that. And but anyway, she's getting lots better, and we hope in a week or two maybe we can see her over here on this piano. But just keep her in your prayers. Also,
Thank you, Diane.
Yes. I had them notes. just forgot to read them. You know, since I've been gone, Dave stepped up. Diane stepped up since Deanie's been gone. This guy here stepped up, helped us out up here. And Renee's been taking care of the songs, and I just greatly appreciate all of you. I mean, things happen, and this church has always been that way. Somebody step up and take over, and I appreciate that. I had a couple of dear friends I've lost past week and a half, and Coy Leggett over at Sterling. A lot of you know Coy, and he was getting up in years, 90-something, but Coy was really a good neighbor, and we lost him this week. Then I had an old friend up in Welch. Kelly's sitting here, and when I mention his name, he'll grin. But Ron Rotman, he was a neighbor of ours. I met him in 1970 at the Lincoln, Nebraska State Fair. And I moved up in that country in 74, and he showed up on my doorstep. And about 4 years later, we were neighbors. He just lived down the road from me and had a place across the road from me. And he was a full-blood German. I'd say this in church, but he loved beer, hot or cold. He loved beer. He was German. And tell this story on him. He come over to borrow a mower or something from me one day, and he had a blade on his old Poppin' Johnny, and it's 110 degrees, and he was wearing these old camouflage breeches with great big pockets on them. He needed some tools. He had some tools in them breeches. And he pulls out two cans of that beer and sets it up on the hood of his tractor and went taking that. It was, that hood had to be 200 degrees. I said, can you drink that stuff like that? Yeah, yeah. I said, it just gets better. But anyway, he was a wonderful neighbor, and believe it or not, a friend of mine told me he finally quit drinking that stuff, and might have been what killed him. I don't know. But anyway, but remember the families of these two, and they'll need some prayers. There's a lot of things on our bulletin, and just make note of that. Glad you're all here. We're going to salute our flag and have a little break. If you need a cup of coffee or a donut or whatever, help yourself. Visitors, we're glad you're here. My, we're glad you're here, and we want you to come back and see us anytime. Let's salute our flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. If you would, join me in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, God, just thank you for this day and thank you for this church, Lord. And God, such wonderful music this morning on this beautiful day. God, we are so lucky, so blessed to live in this free country. Just be with each one today and give them a safe journey home. For in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
This is Mary's psalm, okay? Mary's psalm. Now, a psalm is a song, just like Danny sang this morning and the choir sang this morning. And so Mary writes this psalm by the power of the Holy Spirit, and I'm going to emphasize that because all Scripture is inspired, and she's one of the authors here. She's not counted as one of the authors of the Bible, but she is, because she writes this psalm, sings this unto God, and it was recorded. Dr. Luke records it and sticks it here in chapter 1, verses 46 through 55. Now, I emphasize that it is inspired by the Holy Spirit, because there's two things in this psalm that make both Baptists mad at me and make both Catholics mad at me. So I'm gonna have some fun here this morning, because I actually lost a family one time when we used this portion of Scripture as a Christmas message. I had a a real conservative Christian family that were good friends, I thought, in my church, and they left after that message. So you'll see why. Because this message will make both Baptists and Catholics smile at some point, and then they'll become angry at another point. Have you ever noticed that people are pretty fickle? You know, I mean, you know, you greet people at the door, and they say, "Oh, Pastor, you must have lost some weight." And the next Sunday, they're going, "Hey, putting on a few pounds, huh?" You just want to smack people. Anyway, this is an interesting psalm. And Mary writes it, of course, after the angel gives her an announcement. And I believe this is written much later than that. I believe it is after the birth of Christ, but it doesn't really matter exactly when it happened. It's very short because Mary is a person, and this may upset you to know this, but hey, I just go from the Word, okay? I just go from the Scripture, have an argument with whoever the author of the Scripture is, okay? Don't argue with me. I'm just telling you what it says. But Mary's a person of very few words. In fact, you'll read in the Scriptures and see that she pondered about a lot of things. She just thought about it. She kept quiet. And when you go through this psalm and other things that she says, and you begin to analyze the original language and how the words that she used and how they were put together and the sentence structure and all that sort of thing, you realize this is a pretty simple person. And I think that's God. God does that. He uses the weak and the foolish of this world to confound the wisdom of the wise. And that's why he uses people like me, really, tell you the truth. Glory can come to the Father through somebody simple like me, because glory doesn't come to me that way. And so Mary's a simple person, and as far as any kind of historical account of her, Josephus, a historical author, writing about his interview with her, and he writes about just a very simple person. And so she's a person of very few words, and this is the psalm that she wrote. Now, to me, people, this is a personal thing here with me. You don't have to believe this, okay? Doesn't make it right or wrong. I think she is referring to the greatest miracle ever committed, and that is beyond, now listen carefully, beyond creation and even the resurrection of Jesus. Now, that's important. Both of those are very important. Without the miracle of creation, creating something out of nothing, we wouldn't be here. Without the resurrection of Jesus, our salvation would not be paid for. So those are very important, aren't they? And they're preached as often the most important miracle ever. To me, this is the most amazing, if not important, it's the most amazing miracle ever done. This is God Himself. God Himself, all that who He is, becomes a man. There's nothing like that. Raising somebody from the dead is taking molecules and rearranging them and breathe life into that. God does that all the time. Every birth is God breathing life into. A resurrection is re-breathing that life back into that person. Creating something out of nothing, well, He's God, right? He can do that. But to make Himself lower than His creation and become a man, become flesh, that's something I'll never understand of a great and mighty and powerful God. Now, you don't have to believe that. That's just my personal opinion, that this is the story about the greatest miracle that ever happened. You know, God with us, Emmanuel. You know, this is amazing. The incarnation of God Himself. It's just, there is nothing like it. Nothing like it. You go home and you ponder that. You ponder what it took for God to reinvent Himself in that sense and become man in the form of Jesus Christ. It's amazing. So that's what this story is about. All right, let's take a look at it. Verses 46. Mary said, this is from Luke chapter 1. Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit has rejoiced in God my Savior, for He has regarded the low estate of this maidservant. For behold, henceforth all generations will call me blessed. For He who is mighty has done great things for me, and holy is His name. And His mercy is on those who fear Him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with His arm. He has scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. He has put down the mighty from their thrones and exalted the lowly. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. He has helped the servant, his servant Israel, in remembrance of his mercy, as he spoke unto our fathers, to Abraham and to his seed forever. Short, very short. But it has a lot of things in it that are very powerful this morning. First of all, I want to share with you her reasoning for why she writes this. Well, you already know that it's because of the birth of Christ. But you got to understand who Mary was, what she went through to, really for your sakes, to have this immaculate conception, this miraculous conception. And to try to explain that to people was unexplainable, even to her own husband. And so an angel had to explain it to him. But her reasoning is found right there in verse 46, to magnify God, to put a magnifying glass on God and to really see who he is. I'm telling you, to think about what she's writing about, this immaculate conception, this creation inside of her, to be the host, to carry this child that is God himself, to be born a man to live among us. Her mind was just blown by the concept, and yours should be too. And we see that she puts a magnifying glass to enlarge the scope of who God is. Have you ever had an experience like that? You're floating along, and all of a sudden some hardship comes in your life, as we've talked about in weeks past, as these psalms are always dealing with some kind of hardship, and then there's the elation of what God does. And in this case, all of a sudden, she who had a small God, all of a sudden has a very, very large and powerful God in her life. Have you ever had that experience? You should. I'll tell you what, it takes something that you're going through that's very difficult and you're just sure God doesn't have an answer. And then he comes through in a mighty powerful way that you never, never expected. Then you magnify God. He all of a sudden has gotten a little bigger. Just a little bigger. Well, one of the things that she sees here for her reasoning to magnify God right there in verse 46. Well, verse 47, here's where the Catholics hate me, all right? She says, God is my Savior. What does that mean? It means Mary's a sinner. That's what it means. Mary needed a Savior just like you and I did. And God performed this miraculous thing because she brought forth this child, and his name shall be called Jesus. That means Savior. And Mary said, I need a Savior. I'm a sinner just like anybody else, and she was. She was just a creation. She was not something special other than the fact that she was an obedient servant, which many of us need to take note of. And so she says, He is my Savior. Praise God. She found a Savior in her own son, Jesus Christ, who died for her sin just like he died for our sin. And that's where the Catholics get all upset at me. Anyway, and the Baptists all go, you know, that's good point, brother. Good point. Good preacher. Good preacher. I'll make you mad here in a few minutes. And then he's miraculous. Verse 49, great things that he has produced here. Man, I'll tell you what, she's really getting an understanding of the miraculous. She is really getting an understanding of the miraculous in this story. He is miraculous. And then he is holy. What does holy mean? It means separate. There's none like him. There's nobody like him. Verse 49. There's nobody like him. For he is mighty. He has done great things for me. And holy is his name. Separate is his name. There is nobody like this God. She had a clear understanding of that. We run to other gods. I'll tell you why I know that, because it's the first thing you run to when you're in trouble. That's your God. That's your God. Money, family, your knowledge, whatever it is. Whatever you're going to use to fix your problem, that's your God. Now, they are gods, little g, but they're very poor gods. Some of you have run to your kids to save your life. You're living vicariously through the great things your kids do because you couldn't do it. You're living vicariously. Let me tell you, kids make very poor gods. Very poor gods. Grandchildren, they make very poor gods. They really do. Your friends, your good name, your money, everything that you've got that you run to, they're gods, all right. Yeah, they'll last for a while, but they're poor. And Mary says, there's a God that's really mighty. He's really great, and there's nothing like him. She understood that in a deeper way. So that's her reasoning, why she is all excited. You know, holy is his name. Is his name. Names were given in that day and age because of events. You have different people that are named in the Bible. You have Barabbas. That means bar means son of, and you'll see a lot of bars in the Bible that way. Not the kind of bars that you might go to, but the kind of bars that are son of. You know, you have different ones. Bartimaeus. That means son of Thomas. Okay, and you see a lot of bar before their name. That means son of, and we have. Barabbas means son of the father. What does that mean? Well, you might say that. You might say it this way, son of a gun. That guy's a son of a gun. Well, Bartimaeus or Abbas was Abbe, his father. He's son of the father. Now, if I ever teach on Barabbas someday, you're going to see how significant that word means. We'll not look at that today. Anyway, so she says, that he is holy, he is separate, he is so different, but it's because of this event. Now, she may have been taught in Hebrew and scholarships and whatever on before, but that means nothing to her now. What means something to her now is this event that she just experienced in a real-time way, okay? And so she's saying there's nobody like this God. And then she understands that God respects certain things, and she calls herself blessed. This is where the Catholics get all excited and say, amen, brother, preach it, and the Baptists get mad at me. And this is where one of the families of my church left because I said this. I want you to see something here. Look at verse 48. For he has regarded the low state of his maidservant, for behold, henceforth. Now this is the Holy Spirit breathing into the Word of God, inspired words, people. You cannot argue with that. This is one of the authors of a small portion of Scripture, empowered by the Holy Spirit. Here she goes. For behold, henceforth, all generations, that's you and me, will call me blessed. Now, I don't care what you think of Mary. I don't care what you think of her. But she truly is blessed. She truly is. And to call her blessed is not a bad thing. It's not being Catholic of you. It's just being scriptural of you. Okay? Now, why would we call her that, or why would we even say that? And I'm not advocating that you should go around and pray Blessed Mary. You shouldn't pray to Mary. She's just a sinner like you and me. That's all she is. Saved by grace. That's it. Why is she blessed? Because she is the only person in the universe that has ever had this experience. That's a blessed experience. Blessed experience. Have you ever had that experience? No, especially you guys. So God chose a person of low estate, probably one of the lowest, I'm assuming, but I would say, according to what I've understood about her, she was a person that was very simple, very simple. And he chose to do something so unique. You see, Satan was out to destroy the lineage of David. He was out to do that. If you read the Bible, if you read the Old Testament, you'll see how Satan was constantly trying to destroy the kings that came through David's lineage, because he was sure that he could destroy the Messiah. He knew the prophecies that the Messiah would come through the lineage of David, right? So all the time, you've got all these kings, right? Because there's going to be a Messiah who's going to sit on the throne of David, right? Okay, so a historical king probably in the line of David, in his lineage. So all these kings are destroyed, 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 corrupted, 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 and on and on and on. Down here, there's another story. Little simple farmers, people that are kind of simple and stuff, but bloodlines of royalty. All of a sudden, this little girl has no idea, you know, what she is and the meaning of the universe. And all of a sudden, an angel appears to her and says, guess what? you're going to have the Messiah, the one that everybody's been waiting for since Genesis 3. You're going to have him. It's going to be miraculous. And she has this little child who becomes the ruler of the universe, the King of Kings, the Prince of Peace. You know, here is the lineage of David, and Satan's going, what? What just happened? What just happened? Wait a minute, I had this all worked out. I had this all worked out. And God swooped down in here and brought up this little girl, and there she was. She was uniquely blessed by God. Hey, take it or leave it. Don't like it, whatever, you know. Mary was a sinner. Hate me for that. That's what the Bible says. She had to have a Savior just like you and I did. Mary was also blessed. Hate me or leave me, whatever. I don't care. That's what the Bible says. So we're having fun. All right. So anyway, you know, we see this in Psalm 34. If you ever take a chance to go home and read something, read the whole Psalm 34. I picked out a couple verses there for you about how God blesses those of us, the righteous that are in the Lord, and how he can just really encourage you when you're of low estate. Well, three things here that he respects. He respects a humble person. We see that in verse 48 and verse 52. And he also doesn't respect a proud person. You see that in verse 51. Psalm 138 is another one that you can take home and read for yourself. It's about Jerusalem and how that Jerusalem was made humble by the Babylonian Empire. Destroyed and made humble. It was a great city at one time, especially during Solomon's reign. And it was destroyed and it was made humble. And how God swooped underneath and lifted her up out of that Babylonian captivity. And so God knows how to do that. The second one here that she says that God has respect for is found in verse 50. Those who honor him. Those of you who honor God. You honor him by your testimony in the community. You honor him by your love for him. You honor him by studying his word. You honor him by keeping his commandments. You honor him by serving him. Those who honor him, he respects. And that's what it says right there. Exodus 34, 6 and 7. There is a cursing that is given to generation of those that dishonor God. In this portion of Scripture here in verse 50, notice what it says. And his mercy is on those who fear him from generation to generation. So you have those who honor God, it goes from generation to generation. Those who dishonor God, it goes from generation to generation. Have you ever known families in the community that are kind of like, you know? Have you ever met any families like that? We had families around us. When I was a kid growing up, there were certain families. You just didn't get involved with the family because the whole family was just disgusting. I mean, the whole family was a mess, right? Yeah. And then there are families of just really good people. You know, have you ever met that? Whole families of just really good people. You know, they became the doctors, the lawyers, the senators, all that kind of stuff in their community, or just well known for their good deeds and that stuff. You ever met good whole families like that? I mean, maybe you guys don't have anything like that around here. Maybe you got just a mixed bunch of nuts. I don't know. But there are families, whole families that you just stay away from, right? And there are whole families that are just really a blessing to your community. Have you ever met that? That is not a curse or a blessing from God. That is natural consequences of the parents. Parents teaching children after generation, they are like their parents. They are like their grandparents. They are like their great-grandparents. And God says this is what's going to happen, and it goes from generation to generation. But those who honor him, their children probably will grow up the same way. Probably, no guarantee, but probably grow up the same way. And then we see those who are hungry. Now, this is an interesting thing. I didn't know that Mary was starving. Did you know that Mary was starving? No. We have hunger for different things. We have hunger. She had a hunger. Her hunger was to be honored. She was really put down. Can you imagine a young girl who now is pregnant and everybody is saying something about it? In fact, Mary talks about this in just a few minutes. Everybody's saying something about it, and so they want her to explain now. You know, her parents, can you imagine? Her parents, her grandparents, her whole family. I want you to explain this. Joseph, she's betrothed. It means engaged. Back then, it means a lot more than those of you that get engaged 5 or 20 times. Back then, when you got engaged, it was like you were getting married, and you were betrothed. You were promised to one another. No, nothing sexual, but it was a promised thing that you could be engaged for years. It was just a promised thing. He wants to know, why are you pregnant? And guess what she tells everybody? Well, you see, this angel came to me and told me that God was going to make a baby inside of me. Oh, great, Mary. That's just, yeah, I'm going to believe that. And she was put down for this story that she had for 9 months. She goes to help her cousin Elizabeth. She's gone for about 3 months. She comes home very obviously bulging, right? And, you know, she is now this, scorned person in her community. And so she has a hunger. She has a hunger for her name back. She has a hunger for people not to be critical of her. Everyone hungers for something. Are you hungry for something? You're looking for it, probably in all the wrong places, unless you find it in Jesus Christ. God made you with an empty hole inside of your emotional heart. And that hole can only be filled by Jesus Christ. And you're going to search everywhere that you can, and you're going to waste your time and still have nothing to satisfy you. And she found her hunger was filled with this God who respected her. Well, the last thing here is that God remembered. And this is kind of cool. Verses 54 and 55, that God remembered. First of all, he remembered to be helpful. Helpful is one of the things that is in the gifts that God gives to the church. Pastors, evangelists, teachers, prophets, those are people that he gives to the church. And one of the things that they're supposed to do in their list is to be helpful. It's one of the things that God gives. He's a God who likes to be helpful. And you see that in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 28. We, in 1 Thessalonians 5, 14, are challenged to be helpful, to lift up the lowly, to encourage them. We have a group of men on our board who has done a lot in this community and in this church with being helpful and trying to lift up people. They find out people that have a genuine need. There are a lot of people out there that are scammers, but there are people that have genuine needs. And this church helps those kind of people that have genuine needs, mostly people that are related to our church here, because everybody from time to time has genuine needs. And that's something we are told to do. It's not something that we do because we're wonderful people. I mean, we're wonderful, but you know, we don't do it because we're wonderful. We do it because God has told us to do it. It's something that we're supposed to do. We call it benevolence. That's just something that we do. Well, merciful, verse 54. Verse 54 says that he has helped his servant Israel and remembers in remembrance of his mercy. He remembers that he's supposed to be merciful to these people, and he does. Mary says, he's been merciful to us. He could have let us all gone to the dust. But he has brought this Savior, this amazing God-man, into our lives because he's merciful to us as part of Abraham's children. And so that's what he does. You know, what is mercy? Mercy is withholding punishment. When you're talking about bringing a Savior into the world, somebody that you can trust in for your salvation to completely eliminate your sin, that's pretty merciful. Yeah. You know, have you ever seen the advertisements on TV? You know, get the car that you deserve. Get the money that you deserve. Get the lawyer that you deserve. Get the, you know, whatever it is. The bar of soap that you deserve. You know, it's always about what you deserve. You know what we should get if we got what we deserved? You want to know? You all know it, don't you? Yeah, hell, that's what we deserve. Yeah, I don't want to get what I deserve. And God's mercy comes upon us in the form of Jesus Christ, and we do not have to get what we deserve. That's mercy. That's mercy. And she understood that. And the last thing that God remembered was to be personal. Isn't that wonderful? Does God know your name? Yeah, he does. Yeah, he does. Have you ever seen God to get very personal with you? He doesn't do it all the time because he wants you to grow up. But once in a while, he kind of just holds your hand, and he understands, and he puts you on his knee, and he bounces you a little bit, and he tells you it's going to be okay. You ever got a hug from God? You ever do that? And that's to be personal. And verse 48, she says that he lifted me up out of my low estate. Look at verse 50. Verse 50. And his mercy is on those who fear him from generation to generation. His mercy. What does she need mercy from? In a few minutes, you're going to see here. But it was mercy under the pressure that she was under. This pressure that she felt because of this pregnancy. I mean, this girl really went through it for you and for me. She really did. She really went through it as a servant of God. You know why she's blessed? Not just because God chose her, but because she was willing. She was willing. You know, are you willing to suffer for the Lord? A lot of us all serve you, Jesus. Oh, yeah, let me be a servant. I'm a Christian. Let me be. And God asks you to do something that's a little hard, a little difficult. Yeah, well, not that. You know, what's plan B, God? Plan A, I'm not crazy about that one. Give me plan B. What was plan B? Plan B, do plan A. So you have this person who is lifted up out of her low estate in verse 48, under the pressure in verse 50. Verse 51, this is where the rubber meets the road. Look at verse 51. He has shown strength with his arm. He has just come right down under her and picked her up. He has scattered the proud. Now, who's she talking about? Who is she talking about? He has scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. Do you see where the rubber meets the road here? She's talking about people that are mocking her, people that are putting her down, people that their imaginations are thinking only dirty thoughts about what's going on with this poor girl, and they are just beating up on her psychologically. That's what she's talking about right there. And so he was personal to her to rescue her out of that ridicule. And I like this, verse 55 to conclude. And he spoke to our fathers, to Abraham, and to his seed forever. Who's his seed? That's Mary. That's Mary. She's a Jew, 100%, 100% Jew. And, she's saying that God is very personal to people in these kind of things. No, he's personal to me. He's personal to me. Do you know God? Do you have a relationship with him in a way that is personal? I mean, this is who he is. She knew firsthand the support of God. And this is a girl that really went through it. And life didn't get really much better for her. Didn't really get much better for her. If you study Mary and understand what she went through and understand losing her husband probably pretty early in her life, trying to work for herself, doing some catering, I believe, and had her kids kind of help her, and then she's got this son who does, he takes off and he ends up getting tortured and butchered. And she knew it was all because of God's will. You know, this is a girl that really went through it. Really went through it. Mary's psalm. Where are you this morning? Are you going through it? You having a hard time? We all do, don't we? Yeah. And so, who's the answer to that? Where are you going to run to? You got a small g God in your life that you're running to? Or you got a powerful, great God like this one? That was what Mary had, and she understood it. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for this story and this amazing miracle, God. Probably the greatest miracle ever committed. It's just amazing. God becoming man. Nothing like that. Nothing like that. Just how that you preserved the lineage of David through the humble people that you did it through. How that you used the weak and the foolish to do great things. How that you can use us, and how that this young girl found a God that was worthy to praise and to magnify. Just came a little bigger. May you be big in our eyes, Lord, and we'll praise you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Good morning. God bless you.